Assalamu alaikum. Today I will be teaching you about drug reactions. This topic is very important from your exact point of view because SCQs can come from it. Now, what are the types of drug reactions? Basically, there are three: erythema multiforme, Stevens-Johnson syndrome, and toxic epidermal necrolysis. Now, what is erythema multiforme? It is a hypersensitivity reaction usually triggered by infections. Most common infection is herpes simplex infection. Presents with a skin eruption which is characterized by a typical target lesion. Mucous membrane involvement may be present or it may be not. Now, regarding its etiology, a cutaneous reaction to a variety of antigenic stimuli is erythema multiforme infection, especially following herpes simplex or mycoplasma. Drugs, sulfonamides, phenytoin, barbiturates, phenylbutazone, penicillin, allopurinol, they are the most commonest culprits. And then it can be idiopathic, probably also again due to herpes simplex or mycoplasma. Regarding the triggering factors, they can be either viral infections, bacterial infections, or fungal infection. In viral infections like parapox, virus of Wilkes nodule, varicella like chickenpox, shingles, and hepatitis B infection. Bacterial like rickettsia, and in fungal infection like tinea. Now, regarding the clinical manifestations, it is a common reaction pattern of blood vessels in the dermis with secondary epidermal changes. It manifests clinically as characteristic erythematous iris shaped targetoid papular and vesicular bullous lesion, typically involving the extremities, especially the palms and soles and the mucous membranes, benign course with frequent recurrences. The good thing is that it has got a benign course, but the bad thing about it is that the recurrences are very frequent. Now, regarding erythema multiforme, it can be further divided into two types, either erythema major or erythema minor. And it is considered to be a distinct form from Stevens-Johnson and toxic epidermal necrolysis. Sites of involvement. Basically, distal extremities, especially the hands, are most commonly involved. Upper limbs are more commonly infected as compared to lower limbs, palms, soles, trunk and mucosal surfaces may be affected. The face is less commonly affected. Now, what is the difference between erythema multiforme minor and erythema multiforme major clinically? In minor, little or no mucous membrane involvement, only vesicles, no bullae. Whereas in erythema multiforme major, mucous membrane involvement is present, bullae and even systemic symptoms like fever, malaise will be present. Now, this is a picture of showing typical target lesions. You can see there is a dusky red erythema in the center. Then there is a halo of pallor, and then again there is another halo of erythema again. These are typical lesions for erythema multiforme. Now, this is involvement like lips, palate, gingiva. Lots of small lesions arise which then coalesce. Conjunctiva, eye involvement is usually mild. Genitalia, it may be severe involvement, and other mucosae can also be involved. Now, you can see this is a picture of mucosal involvement. You can see that erosions are present and crusting can also be seen on the lower lip. Now, regarding the diagnosis, basically it is a clinical diagnosis. But in some cases, you can go ahead for biopsy. In biopsy, what changes you can find is that basically apoptotic individual keratinocytes is the earliest histological change, then hydropic degeneration of basal keratinocytes, intercellular edema, that is spongiosis, and you can even see the split within the epidermis, and dermal changes may be present secondarily, that is moderate or dense perivascular lymphocytic infiltrate in the papillary dermis and also along the dermoepidermal junction. Eosinophilic infiltrates, they can be found as well. Now, regarding the treatment, general measures are required. Then you have got to, in general measures, what you can see is that if the culprit is the drug, you are supposed to stop it. Okay. Supportive treatment is all that is required for the majority of erythema multiforme cases. If eye involvement, it requires the early help of an ophthalmologist. Then in cases of recurrent cases of moderate to severe mucosal lesions, you can give a mouthwash. Those already on prophylactic acyclovir, consider prednisolone starting at 40 mg OD and then reducing down over to 10-14 days. In more severe cases, like in cases of erythema multiforme major, hospital admission is usually required. Role of systemic steroids again remains controversial. Some people give it and some don't. Regarding its prevention, recurrent erythema multiforme secondary to herpes simplex should be treated with prophylactic oral acyclovir. And if it is felt to be secondary to a drug, as I told you before, then it should be withdrawn. That drug should not be given to the patient again. The patient should be told that whenever he or she visits a doctor for some other problem, he should inform the doctor before he gives the prescription to them. Now, Stevens-Johnson syndrome and toxic epidermal necrolysis, basically they are acute life-threatening mucocutaneous reactions which are characterized by extensive necrosis and detachment of the epidermis. They can be either idiopathic or drug-induced. When the epidermal detachment is less than 10%, you label as SGS, and when it is more than 30%, then it label as 10, that is toxic epidermal necrolysis. And when it is in between 10 to 30% of epidermal detachment, then it is overlap of SGS or 10. This topic is very important from your exam point of view. SCQs may come from it. Regarding etiology, anyone on medication can develop SGS or 10 unpredictably. It can affect all age groups and all ages and races as well. It is slightly more common in females than in males and 100 times more common in association with HIV. Genetic factors are important. There are some HLA associations in some races to anticonvulsants and allopurinol. Polymorphism to specific genes have been detected as well, especially in patients who reacting to anticonvulsants. It is more often seen with drugs which have got a long half-life compared to even a chemically similar related drug with a short half-life. The medications are usually systemic, either taken by mouth or injection, but 10 has been reported even with some topical use. No drug is implicated in about 20% of the cases. You can't reach the culprit drug. It has rarely been associated with vaccination and infections as mycoplasma and cytomegalovirus infection. They are generally associated with mucosal involvement and less severe cutaneous disease than when drugs are the causative agents. The drugs which are at high risk, they are almost the same as that of in case of erythema multiforme. They are allopurinol, sulfamethoxazole, sulfonylureas, that is sulfa drugs, sulfapyridine, sulfasalazine. Then carbamazepine, lamotrigine, phenobarbital, phenytoin, nevirapine. Lower risk drugs are acetic acid, NSAIDs, minopenicillin, cephalosporins, quinolones, and even macrolides. And the list goes on because it is an unpredictable, anybody can have a reaction to any drug at the first time of usage. It is viewed as a cytotoxic immune reaction aimed at the destruction of keratinocytes expressing foreign drug-related antigens. Epidermal injury is based on the induction of apoptosis, that is, death of keratinocytes. Regarding the clinical presentations, SGS and 10 usually develop within the first week of antibiotic therapy and even up to 2 months after starting an anticonvulsant therapy. For most drugs, the onset is within a few days for up to 1 month. Before the rash appears, there is usually a prodromal illness of several days duration resembling an upper respiratory tract infection or flu-like illness. Symptoms may include fever, sore throat, difficulty in swallowing, runny nose and cough, sore, red eyes, conjunctivitis, general aches and pain. That is like flu-like symptoms will be present. Then there is an abrupt onset of a tender, painful red skin rash starting on the trunk and extending rapidly over hours to days onto the face and limbs, but rarely affecting the scalp, palms or soles. The maximum extent is usually reached within a period of about 3 to 4 days. Regarding the skin lesions, they may be either macules, flat, red and diffuse, measles-like spots or purple purpuric spots. Diffuse erythema or they may be targeted lesion just like in erythema multiforme. Blisters, they are flaccid, that is, they are not tense. The blisters then merge to form sheets of skin detachment exposing red oozing dermis. The Nikolsky sign is positive in areas of skin redness. This means that blisters and erosions appear when the skin is rubbed gently. At least two mucosal surfaces are affected including eyes, conjunctivitis, less softened corneal ulceration, anterior uveitis, panophthalmitis, red sores, sticky photosensitive eyes. Patient may complain of a gritty sensation or a foreign body sensation. Lips or mouths lead to keratitis or stomatitis, and red crusted lips, painful mouth ulcers may be present. Pharynx and esophagus causing difficulty in eating, genital area and urinary tract, erosions, ulcers, even urinary retention. In case of upper respiratory tract, cough and respiratory distress. In case of GIT, diarrhea, the patient is very ill, extremely anxious and in considerable pain. In addition to skin mucosa and involvement, other organs may be affected, that is multi-system organ involvement can be present, like liver, kidneys, bone marrow, lungs and even joints may be involved. It can be very fatal because of certain complications in the acute phase. The mortality rate is up to 10% for SJS and at least 30% for TEN. During the acute phase, potentially fatal complications include dehydration and acute malnutrition, infection of skin, mucous membrane, lungs, like pneumonia and septicemia, acute respiratory distress syndrome, gastrointestinal ulceration, perforation and intussusception, shock and multiple organ failure, even acute kidney failure is the most commonest. Thromboembolism and disseminated intravascular coagulopathy can also be present. Regarding the investigations, elevated levels of serum granulocyte taken in the first few days of a drug eruption may be predictive of SJS-10, but is usually not available. Skin biopsy is usually required to confirm the clinical diagnosis and to exclude other differentials like staphylococcal scalded skin syndrome and other generalized rashes with blisters, especially pemphigus, paraneoplastic pemphigus, pemphigus vulgaris as well. Regarding the skin biopsy, the histopathology will show us the keratinocyte necrosis, full thickness epidermal necrosis, that is the death of entire layer of skin, minimal inflammation, very mild lymphocytic infiltrate of the superficial dermis may be seen. Now regarding the predictability of how will be the course of the disease, there is a score, that is Quarton score. It is an illness severity score that has been developed to predict mortality in SJS in 10 cases. 1 point is scored for each of the 7 criteria present at the time of admission. The Quarton criteria are: if the patient has got age greater than 40 years, presence of malignancy, heart rate greater than 120 beats per minute, initial percentage of epidermal detachment is greater than 10%, serum urea level greater than 10 millimoles per liter, serum glucose level greater than 14 millimoles per liter, serum bicarbonate levels less than 20 millimoles per liter. The risk of dying from SJS or 10 depends on the score. If the Quarton score is 0 to 1, then the risk is greater than 3.2%. If score is more than 2%, if score is 2, sorry, then the risk is greater than 12.1%. If the score is 3, then the risk is greater than 35.3%. If the score is 4, then it is greater than 58%. Quarton 5 or more, is the risk is greater than 90%. In 2019, a new prediction model was proposed, which is known as ABCD10. A, age over 50 years, it has got 1 point. B is bicarbonate level, when it is less than 20 millimoles per liter, it has got 1 point. C, if the cancer is present and active, 2 points. D is dialysis prior to admission, 3 points. 10 is epidermal detachment greater than or equal to 10% body surface area on admission. These are pictures of Stevens-Johnson syndrome. You can see that there is coating of the tongue with whitish slough. This is basically candidiasis, and you can see hemorrhagic crusting on the lower lip and erosions as well. Now you can see that this is the typical picture like burn. You can see the bullae are present, and then there is erosion. Then there, in the further on, there will be exfoliation of skin. Sheets of skin will be removed. Now this is the close-up picture. You can see the erosions. The whole of the epidermis is detached. Now regarding the treatment, nursing care is very important. Cessation of the suspected positive drug is the first thing which should be done. Hospital admission preferably immediately to an intensive care and burn unit with specialist nursing care, as this improves survival, reduces the infection and shortens the hospital stay. Consider fluidized air bed, nutritional and fluid replacement, crystalloid by intravenous and nasogastric routes, and it should be reviewed and adjusted daily. Temperature maintenance, as body temperature regulation is impaired, the patient should be in a warm room, 30 to 32 degrees Celsius. Pain relief, as pain can be extreme. Sterile handling and reverse isolation procedures. Regarding the skin care, examine daily for the extent of detachment and infection. Take swabs for bacterial culture. Topical antiseptics can be used like silver nitrate, chlorhexidine, but not silver sulfadiazine, as it is a sulfur drug. Dressings, gauze with petrolatum, non-adherent nanocrystalline containing silver gauze or biosynthetic skin substitutes can reduce the pain. Avoid using adhesive tapes and unnecessary removal of dead skin. Leave the blister roof as it is a biological dressing. Eye care, daily assessment by an ophthalmologist is needed. Frequent eye drops or ointments, antiseptics, antibiotics or corticosteroids can be given according to the need of the patient. Mucosal care, for mouth care, mouthwashes, topical oral anesthetics can be prescribed. For genital care, if ulcerated, prevent vaginal adhesions using intravaginal steroid ointments or soft vaginal dilatives. Regarding the general care, psychiatric support for extreme anxiety and emotional lability, physiotherapy to maintain joint movement and reduce the risk of pneumonia, because contracture formation is very common, so physiotherapy is important in that case. Regular assessment for staphylococcal or gram-negative infection. The appropriate antibiotic should be given if an infection develops. Prophylactic antibiotics are not recommended and may even increase the risk of sepsis. Consider heparin to prevent thromboembolism, that is blood clot formation. The role of systemic corticosteroids against still remains controversial. Some people start it and then they give even prophylactic oral antiviral and oral antibiotics as well. Even they give antifungals. Now, other options like anti-TNF-alpha monoclonal antibodies like infliximab, etanercept, cyclophosphamide, intravenous immunoglobulins are commonly used, but they are expensive, 2 to 3 grams per kg given over 2 to 3 days. Plasmapheresis is also commonly used. Granulocyte clonal stimulating factor can be used. Thalidomide is not used because it led to increased mortality. Now, these are the further short essay questions are 2 and they are 2 MCQs. So if there are certain queries about the lecture, you can ask me. This is the first SEQ, then this is the second, and these are 2 MCQs. Okay. If there are any queries, you are most welcome to ask me about it. Okay. Thank you.